Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Emergency Operations Center Daily Press Conference. I'm Christy Sandel. We're going to start here in Pierre with our official, with Governor Dugard and our other officials. Then we'll go down to Nathan at Dakota Valley, and then we'll come back here and do questions. Governor Dugard.
Thank you, Christy, and thank you, everyone, for joining us again for today's news conference on flood matters. I'd like to begin, as I have on other days, with a reminder that safety should be our first priority, personal safety. I would like to emphasize that all citizens should stay off the Missouri River. The Coast Guard has closed the Missouri River for boating from Sioux City South, and I've asked the Coast Guard to do likewise between Gavin's Point Dam and the Sioux River and Missouri River confluence. I'm also asking the Coast Guard to close the Sioux River from the confluence with the Missouri up to Military Road, which is named Military Road both in North Sioux City, South Dakota, and in Sioux City, Iowa. There are what many people are calling missiles in river parlance on the river, everything from refrigerators to propane tanks to logs, to parts of decks are floating down the river. And those fixed objects, which those boaters familiar with the river would typically look to find and see, are often now submerged, sometimes just below the surface. And so they represent no longer marks by which one may navigate, but now hazards. So please, everyone, stay off the Missouri River downstream from Gavin's Point Dam. That being said, I would like to encourage visitors to South Dakota to recognize that our reservoirs continue to be an attraction for visitors and tourism and remain that way. All boat ramps and campgrounds on Lake Oahe and Lewis and Clark Lake remain open, and we're hoping that tourists will continue to make South Dakota their vacation destination. The West Boat Ramp just above Lake Oahe's dam face may be restricted, and we want to discourage boaters from approaching the face of Oahe Dam and stay about a half mile away from the dam face. Otherwise, everything else is open, and we encourage visitors to enjoy the great faces and great places of South Dakota. The levees in Pierre and Fort Pierre are in good shape. I walked them again this morning. There are other levees continuing construction in southeast South Dakota. We have levees in many communities along the reach from Gavin's Point to Sioux City. Windstone area, I know, is under construction. McCook and North Sioux City, the Sun Coast area. Mayor Fuchsa will be describing that, I know, in his comments. But we're pleased with the behavior of the levees that have been completed thus far and hopeful of completion of the downstream levees in time for increased flows from Gavin's Point. Maps for the southeast region are improved and posted on the BeReadySD.com website. So if you live in Windstone or you live in the McCook Lake area or in Dakota Dunes, anywhere down that stretch of the river near Yankton, there are many maps there that have topographical lines that are more easily read than maps that were posted previously. So take a look if you're interested down there. I want to say a public thank you to Governor Mark Dayton in Minnesota for sending the two Blackhawks that we requested yesterday. Both arrived in South Dakota. Both are equipped with hoists. We have one in the southeast area that will serve the reach from Gavin's Point down, and one that's based in Pierre and Fort Pierre to serve this area where I am this morning. We have sent the Iowa Blackhawk that had no hoist back home with our thanks to Governor Branstad. I also want to say a thank you to Union County officials, especially a shout out to Sheriff Dan Limoges. He and other Union County officials are assisting many localities within their borders, helping them with coordinating National Guard and other state support. All Emergency response begins at the local level, and certainly the emergency management folks in Clay, Union, and Yankton counties, as well as their public officials, are working overtime and very hard to help their citizens respond to emergencies. Today, in fact, as we are meeting at Union County, there's a meeting going on among FEMA, state, and local officials about how the costs that are being incurred by local governments might be accounted for, and to encourage local auditors and other city finance officers and folks like that understand how to keep track of those costs to preserve what eligibility they may have to apply for reimbursement from FEMA. That's all I have. Again, I would say I continue to be impressed by the tremendous sense of community that we see up and down this river from South Dakotans all across the state and even without our borders, who are coming together to help those folks in the communities affected by this flooding respond and protect themselves as best they can. It really is showing the best of human nature in this difficult time.
Thank you, Governor. We'll now hear from Eric Stosch and Lee J. Templeton with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers to get a report on water levels and the reservoirs.
For the Lake Oahe pool elevation today, we're sitting at 1619.2. That's up, there's a minor increase over yesterday with that report. The reservoir now is discharging the 150,000 cubic feet per second. I have a river gauge at 10 o'clock of 1434.1. And that's pretty much right on target where we thought it would be. I'll pass it now for Lee J. Downriver.
Good morning. The release schedule for Gavin's Point. Today we'll be increasing the flow rate out of the powerhouse from 120,000 CFS to 130,000 CFS, and that has begun. As of 0800 this morning, there was an increase of 5,000 CFS to 125,000 CFS. And at 3 o'clock, we will increase the flow rate to another 5,000 CFS to 130,000 CFS. And that is the scheduled release rate for the day. Tomorrow, we'll go to 140,000 CFS. On the 10th, we'll go to 145,000 CFS. And on the 14th, we're expected to go to 150,000 CFS. That schedule has not changed from any previous announcements. Current water elevations that we expect to see today in Yankton are 1162.1 in the Windstone area, 1094.3 in the Dakota Dunes area, 1095.3. And there is some time lag, obviously, as the flow rates increase from Gavin's Point, as that water makes its way down the 59-mile stretch until it reaches Sioux City. You can find more detailed information, which relates the date and the flow rate to where you live, on the BeReadySD.com site. So there's more information there if you would like to get it. Thank you. That's all I have for today.
Thank you, gentlemen. We'll now go to our local officials. We have Peer Mayor Lori Gill and Fort Peer Mayor Sam Tidball, and then we'll send it down to Nathan.
All right, this is Peer Mayor Lori Gill. The safety of the public in this area and the stability of utilities remain our top focus from the city perspective. The City of Peer crews are working 12-hour shifts and will continue to do so as we monitor our systems and see how we're holding up against the current river levels. Our electric utility is stable. Crews will be sandbagging critical switches as appropriate. We remain confident that we will be able to supply electricity in the area as we're moving through this. In terms of water, our wells are functioning as expected and water quality remains good. The most critical area in terms of utilities right now that we're focusing on is the storm sewer area, and crews are working day and night to control water flows through the stormwater system. We have utilized divers in the pier area to plug a storm outlet that has been successful. That remains the area that we will be continually watching as the river's rising and responding to anything that we need to as we're moving along. In terms of levees, the levee construction on Sully Street has made major progress, and that's a levee that we're adding to pick up some additional city infrastructure, and we'll be tying into the Corps of Engineers levees. We hope to have that done shortly. Levee surveillance is underway, and the call system and reporting system are operational. We are being supplanted by the National Guard, and they're working with city crews to provide assistance. Also, we're getting help from various law enforcement agencies to have surveillance of our levees in place, a monitoring system, and a reporting system, and then we can get any repairs in place as we're needed. So that system is working well. Credentialing system for folks that have chosen to evacuate their homes and businesses is proceeding. Adjustments are being made to the process as we're going. We're hearing from citizens as to ways to make it more efficient and effective, and we're listening to them. We're making changes that we need to. Once again, the reminder of this system is being put into place to provide reassurance to citizens that choose to evacuate, that their homes will be patrolled, they will be safe, and at the same time, we're trying to develop a process that allows access, open access, for property owners to their structures. Once folks get credentials and have their ID, they'll have open access to their homes. But just a reminder to carry your cards when you're going back in to take a look at your property. The credentialing process continues today at George Morris Middle School from noon until 8 in the library of the middle school, and we will provide ongoing credentialing beyond today at fire station number 4 in Pier. And lastly, in terms of the Red Cross shelter that has been set up at George Morris Middle School, we have had 50 people since we've begun register at the Red Cross shelter. For those that have evacuated their homes and need a place to shower, we are providing at the Red Cross shelter at the middle school times for folks to get showers, and that will be 10 to 11:30 a.m. and 9:15 to 10:30 p.m. Bring your own towels and your own toiletries, and we'll be able to provide showers to folks that need it. That concludes the peer report.
Okay. Sam Tidball, Fort Pier. Primarily our effort, current effort, is more on monitoring and dealing with minor problems. On the levees, I think, as the governor mentioned, they're doing well. I think they're doing the job they're designed for, and those levees are being patrolled or surveyed. Surveys, surveillance on them continues, and so it's also comforting to know that there's a helicopter crew standing by, as Governor Dugard mentioned, that in case we do have a breach of the levee, there's an emergency response team there to help with that. So that's great to know that. And the north part of the city, some protective and minor improvements to levees are being made, are being worked on at the present time. In the city, we have only one storm drain that we haven't been able to completely seal, and that's on Fifth Avenue. That outlet to the river has been sealed, but water is feeding back from some unknown source. So we're working on that and hope to isolate and fix that today. We're working to improve dewatering where water is seeping in through the groundwater, and trying to get the other water levels back down all the way through the city. We keep adding pumps to get that water down and keep it down. Our utilities, we're continuing operating all our utilities of water, sewer, and electric. Credentialing goes, as Mayor Gill mentioned, that's the same for Fort Pier. And so that's just the same process. I won't reiterate that. Just a little note to the media representatives. I want to thank most of you for all the good job you've done in getting information out to the public. Good factual information on a positive note, and I really appreciate that. Not dwelling on the minor problems that we have. We are, I think, in the community doing very well, considering the problem was thrown at us in such a short time to do anything about it. Our community has responded in a very cooperative and neighborly way that makes me very proud and thankful for the way that everyone helped each other, and thanks to the hundreds of volunteers. Be safe and positive. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayors. We'll now go down to Nathan for the local reports from the Southeast area.
Thank you, Christy. My name is Nathan Sanderson. I'm the Public Information Officer for the Incident Management Team operating here in the Southeast area. Before we move to a couple of the community members down here, I'd like to thank Superintendent Al Lieber of the Dakota Valley School District. He's really been fantastic in accommodating us down here. As I mentioned before, he's got sandbagging operations in the parking lot. He's held public meetings in his facilities and then several press conferences. So thank you to Superintendent Lieber. Down here at Dakota Valley today, we've got Jeff Dooley of the Dakota Dunes Community Improvement District and Mayor Don Fuchsa of North Sioux City. First, we'll turn to Jeff Dooley. Jeff?
Thank you, Nathan. First of all, I'd like to point out to the residents in this area, Winstone, Dakota Dunes, that, you know, the core release schedule that was outlined earlier in this call has not changed. It's been in place here for the last few days, and it's been the schedule that we have been following for the building of our levees. And like I said yesterday, we're trying to parallel and stay ahead of that schedule. So I don't want anybody to think that the releases are higher or faster. They're the same, and we're planning for that. In regards to infrastructure, I'll start with the sanitary sewer system. The flows at our North Lift Station have been are way lower than they have been in the past, which is expected for the number of people that are currently being served. That kind of indicates that we don't have a lot of infiltration in our system right now from groundwater. So we should be able to keep up with that pumping. We are making plans to completely seal off the sanitary sewer system if necessary from the evacuated area to ensure that we don't get any inundation problems. But like I said, the flows currently at our North Lift Station don't indicate that there are any infiltration issues right now. The North Lift Station is where all the sewer, all the wastewater from the dunes flows to and gets pumped to Sioux City for treatment. So that's a good place to gauge that. In regards to water, we have shut down our water treatment plant. We are currently getting water from the city of Sioux City through our connection. That connection is a permanent connection. We've had that for about 9 years now. It was a connection that we made with them so that we would have a secondary source and to supplement our current source. So we don't have any issues on the water side yet, but I would encourage the residents of Dakota Dunes, those of you that are in the Prairie Meadows and the business area, to please conserve water where you can. Please turn off your irrigation system so we don't create any other issues. In regards to storm sewers, we continue to fight that battle too, not necessarily with the city or the CID storm sewers that went out into the street or out into the river, but there's a lot of yard drains and that kind of stuff that kind of pop up from here to here and there, and we try to deal with that as they come up. The incident command team call center has indicated that we've been getting a lot of calls from residents from the evacuated area, asking if they can go back to their homes. You know, the answer to that right now is no. You can't go back to the homes. We're really limited access to that just for levee building and dewatering issues right now. And I said in the call yesterday and in the news conference yesterday, we need to get this levee system built. We need to get our dewatering system in place, get it pumping, and find out what the conditions are going to be within that area. And then maybe we can reassess the situation. But in the immediate short term, please do not make plans to go down in there because you won't be allowed down into the evacuated area. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Nathan.
Thank you, Jeff. Next, we'll hear from Mayor of North Sioux City, Don Fuchsa.
Thank you, Nathan. In the McCook Lake, North Sioux City area, our sanitary and infrastructure, sanitary system, infrastructure is flooring as normal. The city is prepared to secure it as needed. We are not to that point in time yet in our area. The second thing would be the levees. The city, with the, in conjunction with the team on the ground here, is continuing to work on the levee system, which would basically stretch from the Cook Lake area, tying into the Windstone area, and then helping some of the folks as well protect them that are in the Union County outside city limits area. Third thing I would just like to mention is that the city of North Sioux City has scheduled a public meeting, informational meeting, tomorrow night, Wednesday at 6 p.m. at the Dakota Valley Elementary School for our residents. This would be particularly pertaining to the North Sioux City McCook Lake residents. There is no new information. Everything is status quo as far as from yesterday. We just want to bring people up to speed. The last thing, and I'll turn it back over to Nathan, is that the residential sandbagging effort here is, I'm sure in the rest of the communities up through the system, has been outstanding. These folks have acted in a tremendously orderly, speedy fashion to get accomplished what they need to done. That's it from the McCook Lake, North Sioux City area.
Thank you. Next, we will turn it to Joe Lowe, the incident commander of the Type 2 team down here managing in the southeast area, for an update on levee construction throughout the southeast area. Joe?
Good morning. Thank you, Nathan. I'm Joe Lowe. I'm the incident commander for Rocky Mountain Team C, operating in the southeast area here. I think first thing is I got a chance to get up in this helicopter yesterday and see much of this operational area that we're covering here. And one thing that I did see is this river is angry. It's starting to flow real well. Safety is our, it's been talked about it, but it can't be overstated. The other thing that we need to be aware of is of those people that are in contact with the river. There's a lot of sewage going in that river, and so there will be waterborne pathogens, potential for waterborne pathogens. So when you get out of the water and come contact to it, make sure you wash your hands and wash. There's also, we're starting to see other things floating down the river, refrigerators and empty propane tanks, things like that. Moving down, and let's talk a little bit about our operational area. They're commonly known as, in this area, I understand, Cottonwood and Miner's Bend. That area, we've got five residents that are still staying there. And we've asked them numerous times, we are going to continue to reinforce the issue. This is a dangerous river at this time. And they're now, they're going in by boats. The river is got to a point now where the roadway going out is compromised. We're aware they're there, and the last thing that we want to do is have to go out and extract them. So I hope that they are listening, taking heed, and going to move out of that with the boats that they do have, and if not, if they need assistance, we will get them out there. Let's move to Windstone. Windstone, at this point, a levee is being constructed and reinforced on state land adjoining the Windstone community, and is expected to reach a height of 1104 above sea level. The levee will merge with other levees being constructed to protect Cook Lake, McCook Lake, North Sioux City, and Union and other Union County residents, forming a large single levee. Want to emphasize, Union County is working to assist over there, and our state resources are committed. The National Guard is continuing to assist volunteers building sandbags. They have also sandbagged around a water treatment plant. 110 guardsmen will again be in the area to assist with sandbagging operations. More than 36,000 sandbags have been produced since Sunday. Or Saturday, excuse me. As I move down river, we get to Dakota Dunes. We get to Dakota Dunes. This is a pivotal day We're starting to see this river starting to charge against the outside of the levee. And I want to caution us at this time. More than 85% of the Dakota Dunes levee system is built to a height of 1,100, all right? Now, I know the news, you have scanners going and everything else, and you heard that there was a possible breach on Division C of the Dakota Dunes levee system, okay? Understand that you can help us by making sure that the information is true and verified before we need to instill confidence, but we need to react too when it's a real incident. We have people out there, management people out there. We have division group soups. The division group soups were right there. The branch director was right there. That turned out not to be true. The rumor came in from a truck driver who saw dewatering water as an issue. We don't want to discourage that. Everybody has eyes and ears on this thing as this levee is being tested. Okay, so we will continue to respond to those kinds of reports. But it's absolutely necessary that we don't instill a sense of panic in the public, okay? Dakota Dunes, where we are in this thing right now, let's deal with evacuations. 630 homes have been evacuated, and that is a collaborative effort between Union County, the South Dakota National Guard, and the Highway Patrol. And we have an estimated 3,500 people displaced at present. To the levee itself, we talked about the height and that, but we've also, riprap, which is broken concrete pieces, are being used to armor in the shorelines in areas where the levee will be challenged most at first. And that is those areas where we see eddies and we start to see areas that are perpendicular to river flow. That effort is still ongoing. When we talk about right now the valiant efforts of the construction people and the contractors that are out there, there's more than 180 trucks hauling 30,000 yards of material each day. Last night when we were flying into the helicopter, one of those truck drivers missed a turn and was partway off the levee and had to be put back on. But these folks are committed to making this happen. So we also have over 50 pieces of heavy equipment used to construct the levee system. Again, we're putting trucks on that levee about one every 45 seconds. Dewatering issues, they're going very well. We talk about community sandbag. The community sandbagging operation at the Gateway Centers is still going well. Water treatment plant in the evacuation area, as we commonly call the country club portion of the dunes, has been shut down. Sanitary sewer lines have been plugged. In addition, electricity in some of the areas have been turned off. And that is within the evacuation area. For those of you that are still needing sheltering, there is a shelter here at Dakota Valley High School, 1150 North Shore Drive in North Sioux City. There's no residents at this time in it. The American Red Cross continues to operate the shelter at this location. You'll see a lot of incident personnel staying within the shelter though. So do appreciate that, the heavy lift from the American Red Cross. And at this time, I have no other items right now unless you have further questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. With that, we'll turn it back to Christy Sandel at the EOC in Pierre.
We'll open it up to questions. I do want to mention we have J.C. Carpenter. He's the director of the Office of Homeland Security, and he can answer questions about the EOC. To facilitate the questions, we'll take a few here in Pierre. We'll send it back down to Dakota Valley for questions, and then we'll open it up to the phones.
Eric, how high are we from the top of the spillway, and do you know the current speed of the river?
We are 8/10 of a foot below the top of the spillway gates, and I do not know the speed of the water river.
You said, Eric, you said what, eight-tenths?
Eight-tenths.
When do you know, when are you going to know how the river is reacting at 150,000? I mean, when do we see the, after it finally is released, when does it start to stabilize, and when do you know how the river is reacting?
I think we're starting that process right now. I always try to give the river at least 6 hours here to stabilize. The USGS is going to go out and do measurements again, just to make sure that everything's going the way we think it should. So we think we're going to get to a level today, this afternoon, that we're going to see for quite some time.
You say quite some time. We've talked a couple weeks, months. Well, do we have a definite time?
Again, the schedule that we have goes out until 15 July. And right now, our 150,000 CFS release goes to that 15th of July. And that's all the farther we're projecting out at this point.
But there was a Corps official in a teleconference yesterday that said that he believes now you might go out to mid-August. Have you seen anything like that?
To tell you the truth, I've been too busy on the ground to catch some of those, so I wasn't. That all is being discussed and looked at right now in Omaha.
You mentioned that the level of Lake Oahe has gone up a little bit. Is the lake responding the way you'd like it to the release of 140 and now?
The dam is operating as designed.
At 8 tenths of a foot below the spillway, is it projected still to come to 4 tenths of a foot below the spillway?
Our projection right now is to kind of crest right here, and then we're actually projected to fall just a little bit over the next week. Mm-hmm. Our releases now are in front of our inflows, and then I think a little over about a week out, we're supposed to start coming back the other way as Garrison releases come up to their 150,000 release schedule.
Governor, from your standpoint, with all the people that have been working so hard, and we're now at 150,000, I sense there are a lot of people that are just getting tired. Are you worried that maybe people will maybe start to relax a little too much and maybe not remain vigilant, as you have talked about?
Well, I think what we need to do is continue to evaluate the performance of the levees. I was talking with General Reich about the National Guard force that's here. Nearly 600 National Guard soldiers are here. We're going to need a contingent of them to stay here throughout the duration of increased flows, so long as the levee has water behind it. At any point, we need people to surveil that levee. Also, we're going to need the National Guard to stay here to provide a quick response by air or by ground before a more thorough maintenance effort might be undertaken by contractors with heavy equipment. Beyond that, we'll probably look at releasing some National Guard soldiers here in the next a few days after we see how the levees perform at full release levels at the 150 mark. When people start to see the levees performing, assuming they do, for a period of time after we've been at 150, I think it's only human nature to say, well, can we re-enter our homes? Can we re-enter our businesses if we've evacuated them? And I would remind the general public, this has been a voluntary evacuation from the beginning, and every homeowner and every business owner in the affected area is welcome to reoccupy their structure at any time. I think it's the job of government to give as much information about the risk being taken as is available and let adults make decisions about their own personal safety with the knowledge that we have to give them. I will always say that there are many unknowns because this is uncharted water, and we've never had flows at 150. We've never had these levees in place. So while we try to evaluate what will happen based upon what has happened over a day or 2 days or 3 days, history is no guarantor of the future. So we'll continue to advise the citizens about anything we observe that can help them evaluate the risk. But each citizen will make his or her own decision about what risks they want to take and whether they want to occupy areas where we have recommended they not occupy until the water's gone. And even that, as the water recedes, if we go from 150 to 130, the potential inundation area will shrink, and we'll keep citizens informed about that. And so those kinds of things will continue to be evaluated by every citizen as we continue to revise the information we have and make it known.
Forgive me for interrupting you. I thought you were finished.
No, that's fine.
Eric, I was wondering, we had heard a rumor that a couple of the power generating turbines were down. Any truth to that?
No, we, over the months of April and May, we had a couple down for some major rehabilitation work, but all units are online right now.
Thank you. We'll take one more question from here.
Chet Brokaw with Associated Press for Joe Lowe downstream. Joe, could you give kind of a summary of how far along you are constructing the southern and the northern levees there in Dakota Dunes?
Again, could you restate the question for me real quick? I'm sorry.
Yeah, could you give how far along you are in completing the southern and northern levees down there in Dakota Dunes?
Yes, I can. The question was, how far are we along in constructing the levee system in the Dakota Dunes levee system? About 80 to 85% of the levee system is to 1,100 feet. That's the entire levee system. There are still challenges ahead of us, and those challenges, we still have to, a lot of those areas still have to have plastic down, which is being worked on concurrently. And I feel confident that I can't guarantee that this levee system will hold, but I have great confidence that it will. And so we are constantly evaluating that. This is a dynamic incident in nature, and we will continue to monitor and keep staying the course.
Do we have any questions from Dakota Valley?
Yes, go ahead.
Hi, it's Michelle Blank, Sioux City Journal. I had a question on for Joe on do you know I missed the number of displaced people in the dunes. Can you repeat that?
Yes, I can. The question was how many displaced people in the dunes, and I'll go over that again. There are 630 homes evacuated and an estimated 3,500 people displaced.
Thank you. And can this may be for the governor? What day are you pegging, or is FEMA pegging, as far as flood insurance? What is the first day of the 30-day period?
Stan, the question was, what's the first day of the 30-day period? The question is, when does the flood begin? That's the issue, because if you have bought insurance 30 days before your claim, the claim relates to a flood event. And so your claim and the flood, and I may misstate the precision here, but it's my understanding FEMA's identifying tentatively June 1 as the beginning of the event. So if you bought insurance prior to June 1, 30 days, and then experienced a loss on June 1, you'd be covered. If you bought insurance May 20th and experienced a loss on June 1 or June 5th, you would not be covered. Now, those are the real simple examples. There's more complex fact scenarios that I know FEMA is grappling with, and I'm sure they will clarify that in writing, and once we have more clarification, we'll post it on our website.
What day are they paying for the Pier 4 Pier?
Okay, we've got a question down in Dakota Valley.
Can you, just as a means of describing the levee, can you, I know it's built to an elevation, but how tall is it in spots as you're standing next to it? And then also for clarification, is there a projected completion date?
Yeah, I'll restate the question. Huh? Can you, the question was is give me a height from the existing ground where we started, and I'm looking at portions of those of that levee that were built to 11 feet, especially in the Spyglass area or maybe higher, and it varies with the terrain in those areas. So it's quite an accomplishment for those contractors out there doing that job, and the synergy that exists for everyone. Completion date. Before the water reaches the 1098, right? But to answer that question directly, what I'm looking at is we should have most of that, the rest of the levee system after the 80%, that other percentage done and completed, I would say by late this evening or tomorrow. And given that, understand that's an estimate, because like I say, we had a truck that went off partway yesterday and obscured a part of that top of that levee to continue to bring trucks in. That takes a little bit of time to remove those things. So tonight, tomorrow morning, I'm looking at. Thanks.
We have another question here in Dakota Valley.
This question is also for Joe. We've had some people in Winstone concerned that they're saying the levee there is only a pile of sand with plastic over it. And they're wondering if that will be strong enough and if that's a sufficient enough levee to protect it.
That levee, my understanding of that levee that you're looking at when I flew over it was sand, but that is a temporary levee at present, my understanding of it. The permanent levee.
Your line has been muted.
Okay. That is a temporary, like we call a check line, to give us a chance to build that other levee, which is on Game Fish and Parks land, okay, which should help protect that community.
Are we back to peer questions yet?
Yes, I don't see any other questions in Dakota Valley, so we'll turn it back to peer.
This is Austin Cowles with the Daily Republic. I don't know if we're back to peer questions. I have a two-part question. I'll ask my second one after the first. I'm just wondering right now, what's the state of the flooding, you know, between Pier and Dakota Dunes, areas like Chamberlain, things like that? And then I'll have another question afterwards, and please identify whoever answers. Thanks.
This is Dennis Dugard. There is a river rise, of course, as the elevation goes up in the area immediately below Oahe. It also goes up below Big Bend and below Fort Randall, but there are no significantly impacted communities. There's a campground upstream from the Fort Randall Dam that is impacted, but it's mostly farmland that is experiencing inundation, and so it's largely immediately below Oahe and below Gavin's Point, where you've got communities that are impacted.
Can you kind of give a layman's explanation, Peep? And I've heard this question a lot. Why are, you know, areas like Dakota Dunes and Pier getting hammered so hard, but the areas in between aren't? Is it just that that's farmland and it's not as populated, or are there other reasons involved?
Well, I'm not an expert. I'll venture one thing. The areas below Fort Randall, say, for example, I have canoed, and they are either isolated islands, and there may be a few islands that are occupied, but or one I know of, and some residents along the river, but many of them are on bluffs above the river. And on the lowland, that the ebb and flow of the dams discourages people from occupying some of those low-lying areas that are very low. But you are going to have some second homes, vacation homes here and there, but no larger communities.
So the amount of water is still strong in those areas between Pier and Dakota Dunes. It's just not affecting as many people. Am I hearing that right?
Well, I'm probably a poor guy to ask.
I trust you, Governor. Is there anybody else that wants to take that question?
Doesn't look like there's any takers.
One more question from the phone.
Thank you, Nathan. This is Don Fuchs, the mayor of North Sioux City. I would just like to...
I have one question. Are you still there?
Yes, we are.
It's Michelle Link, Sioux City Journal. Governor, can you talk about the $10 million financing agreement or $5 million at a time with Dakota Dunes Management?
First, let me remind everyone that emergency response is always a local responsibility and locally organized. In this case, the Dakota Dunes Improvement District began their efforts to protect their community, just as the Windstone Homeowners Association and Union County is working on a levy there, just as North Sioux City is working on helping protect McCook Lake, just as Fort Pierre is contracted for construction of levees upstream of the bridge, and the City of Pierre has arranged for a levee along Sully Street. All these local communities make their own decisions about what protective measures they want to undertake to protect their public infrastructure and the citizens of their community. Dakota Dunes' effort became so significant in comparison to their cash on hand that they knew they were going to run into problems. And some of the levee system is financed by the Corps of Engineers. Some of it is not. Again, that's true in other places. Some of the pier levee is covered by the Corps. Some of it is not. Some of the Fort Pier levee is covered by the Corps. Some of it is not. That part in Dakota Dunes that is not covered by the Corps, they don't have enough cash flow right now to cover it. And so the state is undertaking a loan to help them cash flow, the contractors who are working round the clock, and we will work out later the terms of repayment once we understand whether or not Dakota Dunes will qualify for federal reimbursement from FEMA. What degree the costs have reached, what is the ability of their taxing power to tax their citizens to pay for it. Many factors will come into play, but in the very near term, the issue was how do we pay our contractor, keep them on the job, keep our protective measures being placed and maintain them for a period until we understand in the end what we have got in terms of bills and how we're going to pay for it.
Thank you.
Do you have any final comments?
I don't. I guess I say I don't and then go right into one. I would just urge everyone again, consider safety, especially in the downstream communities where construction continues. We had a piece of equipment brush a National Guard soldier in this area upstream near Oahe, no injury of any consequence, but it just is a reminder that we are hurrying to complete our protective measures, but let's not sacrifice personal safety to protect property. Please be safe on the river, be safe around construction zones and around your homes as you deal with this flood emergency.
Thank you, Governor, and thank you, everyone, for participating. Have a good day.